debunked Wakefield's claim that he'd found a link between autism and the vaccine for measles, mumps, and rubella.
Here you have none other than Cooper Anderson of the fake news agency CNN telling yet another lie. His statement here relates to a paper published in 1998 in The Lancet, and we'll actually have a look at that paper to see if what Cooper states is real. So here is the paper in question, titled Allele Lymphoid Nodular Hyperplasia, Nonspecific Colitis and Pervasive Developmental Disorder in Children. This paper was put together by a team within the Royal Free Hospital in London, and this included Dr. Andrew Wakefield, and Professor John Walker-Smith. Here you can see the publication date, the 28th of February, 1998. Here we can read, onset of behavioural symptoms was associated by the parents, so Andrew Wakefield is not making this claim, with measles, mumps, and rubella vaccination in 8 of the 12 children, with measles infection in one child and otitis media in another. We will keep scrolling down. Within the paper we can read, in 8 children, the onset of behavioural problems had been linked either by the parents or by the child's physician with measles, mumps and rubella vaccination. 5 had had early adverse reaction to immunisation, rash, fever, delirium and in 3 cases, convulsions. There is no claim being made here by the team at the Royal Free Hospital that autism is related to measles, mumps, and rubella vaccination.
Wakefield's claim that he'd found a link between autism and the vaccine for measles, mumps, and rubella.
Further down, we can read the sentence here, which basically repeats the title of the paper in a way. So, we describe a pattern of colitis and allele lymphonodular hyperplasia in children with developmental disorders. Now it is this disorder within the gut that the team are most interested in, and further we'll read down here. So, however, the uniformity of the intestinal pathological changes and the fact that previous studies have found intestinal dysfunction in children with autistic spectrum disorders suggests that the connection is real and reflects a unique disease process. Now you have to look at the context of this paper. So they are finding a disorder within the gastrointestinal tract, the gut, and here they are saying that it merely suggests that there is a connection with children who are on the autism spectrum. Let's keep looking within this paper. Okay, further down now, we have a rather large paragraph. But basically, this is a reference to other findings and other papers, not that of Andrew Wakefield's or that of John Walker-Smith or the team at the Royal Free Hospital. So let's read. Disintegrative psychosis is recognized as a sequel to measles encephalitis, although in most cases no cause is ever identified. Viral encephalitis may give rise to autistic disorders, particularly when it occurs in early life. Again, this is all referenced here. Rubella virus is associated with autism, and the combined measles, mumps, and rubella vaccine has also been implicated. But reading on, Fordenberg noted that for 15 of 20 autistic children, the first symptoms developed within a week of vaccination. Fordenberg and Gupta are not part of the direct contributors to this particular paper from the Royal Free Hospital. So reading on, Gupta commented on the striking association between measles, mumps and rubella vaccination and the onset of behavioural symptoms in all the children that he had investigated for aggressive autism. Measles virus and the measles vaccination have both been implicated as risk factors for Crohn's disease, and persistent measles vaccine strain virus infection has been found in children with autoimmune hepatitis. Again, these are the findings of others. Further down, we can read. We did not prove an association between measles, mumps, and rubella vaccine and the syndrome, as per the title of this paper, and the syndrome described. Virological studies are underway that may help to resolve this issue. We're now at the very end of the paper. We have identified a chronic enterocolitis in children that may be related to a neuropsychiatric dysfunction. Maybe. In most cases, onset of symptoms was after measles, mumps, and rubella immunization. Further investigations are needed to examine this syndrome and its possible relation to this vaccine. So within this paper, the team are not linking autism to the measles, mumps, and rubella vaccine. Not only that, they're not even saying that the particular pathology within the gut that they have found is related to the vaccine either.
Now, Wakefield is not just any researcher. His 1998 study on autism, Wakefield's claim that he'd found a link between autism and the vaccine for measles, mumps, and rubella.
Now, Anderson Cooper and CNN have lied here, and there has been no dissent from the Lancet or the greater medical community at large, no outrage amidst the lies. Further, Dr. Andrew Wakefield and Professor John Walker-Smith were stripped of their license to practice medicine by the British Medical Board over their association with this paper. Subsequently, though, Professor John Walker-Smith took his case to the High Court, where Justice Mitting was scathing of the findings of the British Medical Board. I could go on and say a lot about the subject, but we will go out with an interview taken by the VaxXed crew where a lady talks about her triplets in this case.
If you can tell us who you are.
Brenda and David McDowell. Hi, how are you doing? We have triplets.
We have look at that.
Triplets that are now 10.
They're 10 years old.
They're 10 now. That's before
so
the injury.
Two boys and a girl?
Two boys and a girl.
And their names? I've written their names on the bus, so I do know.
Richie, Robbie, and Claire, just as they are in that picture.
Yeah, they're gorgeous. Okay. All right, so let's mm-hmm. talk about what happened.
Well, every day in our life was a party. Every single day they were holding hands and smiling and laughing and looking at each other, engaging in each other. And we brought them in at 9 months and 4 days we were doing one vaccine at a time. They were born 36 weeks, triplets, basically 5 pounds each. We did well. They were well, everything was well. They came home after a few days of being monitored in the NICU. And on June 25th, 2007, we brought him in for the pneumococcal shot.
So just that shot?
One shot. And I went in, not with my husband, he was working. I went in with my nanny, and we went in at 10 a.m.
These are all three?
All three, yep. And it was the last one on the page is the June 25th, 2007 was the shot that did it. And we went in at 10 a.m. for the shot. My daughter still has the mark on her leg from the shot. She was the first one to get it, and she screamed and never really stopped screaming after that. But we continued, we didn't know. We did the boys as well. By noon, Claire shut completely off.
Claire,
our daughter, shut off first. It was as if she was blind and deaf and complete failure to thrive, from super, super happy, smiley girl to... this is a picture of her. She had full-blown eye contact. She was super lovely. And she shut right down. And all she did at that moment was stare at the ceiling fan. So that was at noon. We had the shot at 10 a.m. 2 o'clock, we watched Richie shut off. All his raspberry blowing and mama dada and the furniture walking and everything, they just shut off. All the giggles, all the smiles, it, again, failure to thrive. They lost all their reflexes. I'm an educational audiologist. I actually did the test for the stapedial reflex, which is a little muscle in the middle ear, just to see if a muscle they can't control was still working, and it didn't. The stapedial reflex dampens sound, so your ears don't hurt from a really loud sound, and both of them had no stapedial reflex. They stopped blinking, stopped yawning, stopped coughing, stopped sneezing. You could go towards their eyes and they wouldn't even phase, nothing would phase them. They lost their startle reflex. I threw a telephone book on the floor behind them and no startle, nobody even looked to see what it was. So that was 2 o'clock. We watched Richie shut down and I couldn't breathe. But the, here we go. The worst is when we saw the final one shut down. Sorry. Here's Robbie. And we lost Robbie. Robbie looked like he was hit by a bus. Robbie, from that moment on, had a stunned look on his face. If you asked or said his name, he still acted deaf and acted like he couldn't hear, although they did have normal hearing. I had it all tested. But he lost his happiness. This is a first year picture? First birthday.
3 months after the shot.
3 months after the shot. They were no longer engaged in anything or anyone. They lost their smiles. They just were in their own little separate worlds. They never held hands again. They never looked at each other again. Sorry. Vaccine injury is real. We were told it was genetic. And then we were told by geneticists that there's no possible way 3 children were shut off on the same day. That was absolutely statistically impossible, especially being 2 boys and 1 girl. So we were also told we could not sue anyone. We were told we signed for that shot. No doctors could be sued. No vaccine manufacturers could be sued. We found out when they were 5 and a half that there was a vaccine injury court. When we're all getting smartphones around then. That's when I had it at my pocket and started Googling everything. And they then told us that we were too late. They only had 3 years to apply. So we have spent hundreds of thousands of dollars trying to recover them. The only person that we got back is Robbie, the one that was last to shut off.
We're making progress on all three.
We are making progress. So we had severe autism spectrum disorder for all 3 kids entering kindergarten. That's how long that severe, even with all the therapies, interventions, you name it, we did it. We decided to go with the sunrise therapy, which was to try and find happiness in our day. And we have happy little people. They're not mean, they're not aggressive, they're very happy. And I attribute that to the sunrise therapy. But we still have a long ways to go. Richie can only say single, maybe 2 words together. He's in a lot of pain. He grinds his teeth. We're still working on it. Claire is still completely nonverbal, not potty trained. Richie's not fully potty trained. Robbie is now. And Robbie is approaching grade level, but severe OCD. And we're coming along. It's just one day at a time. My husband wanted to kind of tell you what a day in our life can look like. Even, you know, because of
what, what do you do? What's
your property management. Let me tell you what a day in our life is. So you got, say, a 6 or 7 or 8 year old child who's not potty trained. And at 2 or 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, they fill their diaper. Well, you assume that's pretty uncomfortable, so they take it off. Pretty soon, it's all over them. It's all over the bed. In short order, it's all over me. It's all over her. Mm-hmm. I'm snapping at her. She's snapping at me. We're both snapping at the kid, who is the only innocent party in the whole scenario. And the one thing that's conspicuously absent from that scenario is anybody who told you that shot was safe. They're all asleep in their bed. They haven't got a problem in the world.
The hard part about that is I asked the nurse. We actually had to go to Macomb Health Department to get our shots done because I did not have coverage for well baby coverage. So they said it would be a little cheaper because I'm doing 3. The nurse assured me over and over and over again that it would not harm them. It would not. I was so worried about that. And like you just said, where are they now? You know, I did make a report the very next day. I called the nurse. I called Macomb. They wrote it all out and they did not submit it. I found out later it was not sent in. We found out 7 years after we got the vaccine that it was contaminated, and it was pulled from the market a week to 2 weeks after we got the shot. So it was recalled for sterilization issues, and we found out they wouldn't tell us what was wrong with the shot. We found out from a friend who was a doctor, looked up the lot number of the actual shot, and found out that it was it had killed a 2-year-old, and they didn't want the public to know. So that was the actual shot and lot number that we got, and so I guess we're lucky that we didn't lose them. We could have lost all three on the same day completely, but they lie. The first doctor we saw told us to invest in a group home. I mean, seriously. The second, and then we were given a lovely
wanted
big
us to start up the vaccinations again.
Yep. And then the group of doctors we were with when this all happened gave us a breakup letter, and said, "Go ahead."
What happened is we woke up one morning and we had 3 happy, healthy 9-month-old children. By that evening, you know, we took them for a vaccination. By that evening, they were autistic. What we said to our pediatrician is, "We're not going to do anything. We're not going to." Do any more vaccinations until we know what happened here. What they said is, if you don't continue to do exactly what you did the day your children turned autistic, we're going to fire you from our practice. So
they broke up with us.
They broke up.
They sent us a lovely letter saying we were no longer welcome at their practice because we weren't going to continue well baby checks.
And that is the one decision that we'll never regret.
Okay, just so you know, these people on Periscope are deeply sorry for everything that you've been through. It's horrific. It's not okay.
Nobody's okay. They can argue with families that your child, because it might be a single child, was genetic. They can try and put that back on the family and say somehow your genes are weak. But with us having 2 boys and 1 girl, they lose the argument with us, hands down. So we are the living proof that they're all lying.
Right, I'm going to show you some of these hearts because they're coming in thick and strong, these people.
Really?
Love you. Yeah. Have a check. Let me just, sorry. One second.
Okay, yeah.
See these hearts here?
Oh.
Oh, it's so sweet.
They're saying how sorry they are for you. Oh, look at
that. It's beautiful. Thank you. You're not alone. We're not alone. Somehow, I don't know if I'm crazy, but I really believe in my heart that we're going to get them recovered. Because I knew they were so normal before.
See, this tugs. And you may want to watch this back because they're just... This is your new family, by the way.
That's these amazing. People. Look at them.
Wow. These are people that have had the same experience as you, so they're hurting with you. Anyway.
Yeah, we're 80s people. We didn't know enough to go on there.
Thank you, guys. Yeah, so
we'll go home and get Periscope.
They didn't know what Periscope, guys. They've never heard of Periscope, and I said you were going on Periscope. So they, I think, will be joining you guys.
Thank you for all the love. We really appreciate
in,
it.
So you need
thank
to
you,
come
thank
back
you.
And watch this. But okay. Truly, truly sorry.
Thank you. I know, and yours. Thank you for
and
leading the
Josh
way.
Is
thank you.
Patrick's children, you know, it's
everywhere.
Everywhere.
Everywhere I go, I always bring up the conversation. Everywhere I go, I bring up the conversation and I ask people, and they can always name me a friend, a cousin, a relative of theirs. Everyone knows a child with autism now. So when will we stop this?
The VaxXed crew in America have recorded now hundreds of testimonies, and indeed many of them are very compelling. An Italian court found that with reasonable scientific probability, there was a link between the administration of the MMR vaccine and the autistic symptoms displayed by the child. For the most part with all this, parents are simply not being listened to. And that has been a great shame.